Welcome to another discussion of the Younger Dryas Cataclysm. Approximately 12,900 years ago, one or more pieces of a comet impacted the Laurentide ice sheet that covered the Great Lakes region. The extraterrestrial impacts on the ice sheet ejected pieces of glacier ice that bombarded the landscape from the Rocky Mountains to the east coast of the United States. The secondary impacts of the ice boulders made inclined conical cavities that produced elliptical Carolina Bays and Nebraska rainwater basins. The extraterrestrial impact triggered the Younger Dryas cooling event, and the cataclysm caused the extinction of the megafauna and the Clovis people that inhabited North America. Recently, I came across a website called Our World in Data that has the population of the world from 10,000 before the Common Era to the present time. The chart of the human population puts in perspective how humans recovered after the Younger Dryas cataclysm and the subsequent cooling event that lasted 1,300 years. According to the chart, which is derived from various sources, the total world population 10,000 years before the Common Era was 4.43 million people. That is equivalent to the population of Los Angeles today. It is mind-boggling that the number of humans in the whole world 12,000 years ago was so small compared to today. Another interesting number is the population of North America compared to Europe. The chart shows that North America had 1.18 million people compared to only 482,840 in Europe. It is surprising that North America would have more than twice as many people as Europe, considering that North America had been the epicenter of a megafaunal extinction less than 3,000 years before. The numbers are surprising, but we have to take into account that the extraterrestrial impact happened by the Great Lakes and the ice ejecta covered an area from the Rocky Mountains to the east coast of the United States. Mexico was largely spared the severity of the primary and secondary impacts, but it was still affected by the subsequent cooling event. I want to correlate the world population statistics with the data published by Carmen and 100 co-authors in 2015 that identify the Y chromosome bottleneck in the diversity of the human genome. The mitochondrial DNA does not show this bottleneck. These graphs indicate that while human males were experiencing a loss of genetic diversity, the overall human population continued to grow. The graph of the Y chromosome bottleneck shows that the effective population size of human males started decreasing at the Younger Dryas boundary. This is exactly the time of the extraterrestrial impact. The effective population size drops dramatically even after the Younger Dryas cooling event has passed, and then the effective population size increases dramatically. The paper by Carmen plots the female-to-male effective population ratio during the last 140,000 years. There are two remarkable spikes in the human female-to-male ratio that may be correlated to environmental factors. The first one, around 74,000 years ago, may be linked to the Toba supervolcanic eruption at the site of present-day Lake Toba in Sumatra, Indonesia. Some scientists have proposed that a population bottleneck occurred in human evolution after this eruption. The graph seems to confirm that. The second spike in the female-to-male ratio occurs at the Younger Dryas boundary. But notice that the spike in the female-to-male ratio did not start at the Younger Dryas boundary. It actually started around 20,000 years ago. This was a time when the Earth experienced glacial conditions colder than the Younger Dryas. The chart on the upper left shows the glacial conditions that suddenly gave way to the warm Bolling-Alderoid interstadial period, which was then followed by the Younger Dryas cooling event. The increased female-to-male ratios in humans may be explained by the ecological effect of low ambient temperatures. A paper by Ralph Catalano published in 2008 concludes that ambient temperature affects the characteristics of human populations by influencing who survives gestation. In general, fewer human males are born under cold climate conditions. This temperature-dependent birth ratio for humans has also been observed in people living in northern latitudes. A paper by Helles says that warm years bring more suns. A detailed graph by Carmen shows the Y chromosome effective population by region. The graph shows that the Near East recovered from the bottleneck first after having reached a minimum 7,000 years ago. Europe shows a minimum of Y chromosome effective population as late as 5,000 years ago. These are fairly recent dates, considering that the pyramids of Egypt are thought to have been constructed approximately 4,500 years ago. I will now try to superimpose Carmen's graph of the female-to-male ratios for the last 12,000 years over the total world population. Notice that during the most severe portion of the Y chromosome bottleneck, the number of females to males was more than 16 to 1. By stretching Carmen's graph over the same time interval as the world population, we get this image. The birth ratio of females to males 10,000 years before the Common Era was 7 to 1. A world population of 4.33 million people would have had 3.79 million females and only 633,000 males. The population data for 6,000 years before the Common Era shows that North America had a population of 2.54 million and Europe had a population of 1.22 million. Again, North America had about twice as many people as Europe. By 6,000 years before the Common Era, the total world population had grown to 13.2 million. If the birth ratio of females to males was 12 to 1, as Carmen states, then there would have been 12.1 million females and 1.1 million males. The genetic information tells us that women outnumbered men by 12 to 1. Does this tell us anything about who built the Egyptian pyramids? Did women work along with the men to build megalithic structures? The genetic data brings up many questions that need answers. Depictions of Egyptians working do not show women. If women outnumbered men by 12 to 1, what were they doing? There seems to be a discrepancy between the historical accounts and the genetic data. This picture shows about 100 men. There must have been 1,200 women somewhere else. Or perhaps, at the time that the pyramids were built, the female-to-male ratio had already become similar to what it is today. A paper published in 2020 reported the discovery of remains of two prehistoric hunters at an early Holocene site in Highland Peru, including the 9,000-year-old remains of a young woman buried with a well-stocked big-game hunting toolkit. Her burial included a comprehensive array of hunting and animal processing tools that support her hunter status, including stone projectile points for killing large animals, a knife and flakes of rock for removing internal organs, and tools for scraping and tanning hides. The authors concluded that between 30% and 50% of late Pleistocene and early Holocene big game hunters in the Americas may have been women. I stumbled into the website with world data, and I thought that the population information needed to be correlated with the genetic data. I have only scratched the surface. This type of work needs more careful study. It would be nice if scientists from different fields cooperated to correlate information from genetics and archaeology to give us a more accurate picture of the past 10,000 years. Our genome tells us that women played a very important role during this time, but their contributions have been omitted from history, perhaps because in many cultures, even today, women are denied education and literacy, so they don't get to write the books. Think about that. Thank you for joining me in the investigation of the Younger Dryas Cataclysm and its aftermath. My book about the Carolina Bays is available at Amazon. Please subscribe to my YouTube channel to be notified of future videos.